Many supporters of the far-right Brazilian leader Jair Bolsonaro refused to accept his defeat in the presidential election 10 weeks ago. Some camped outside the army headquarters in the capital, Brasilia, calling on the military to intervene. Last month, a group of them even tried to invade the federal police headquarters. But the warnings went unheeded, and on Sunday, thousands of Bolsonaro supporters were able to smash their way into the presidential palace, Congress and the Supreme Court, raising questions about the loyalties of the police. Now, some would argue a day late, Brazilian security forces have moved in to clear the protest camps. At least 1,500 people have been arrested. The new president, Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, has condemned what he called terrorist acts, and other Brazilians agree.
Regarding the demonstrations, I think they're unnecessary. They're an attack against democracy, an attack against the Brazilian population, and in no way is this a form of freedom of expression. This is an attack and terrorism against the country.
But Brazil remains a nation divided, and there are many who do not accept Lula's victory.
We think the Supreme Court has a hand in something that's happening, so we believe that we were robbed at the ballot boxes. That's why there are these demonstrations. And I think it's absurd that a thief president who stole from the country has returned to the crime scene to be re-elected, and he's there being president. It's absurd. It's a shame for the country.
Jair Bolsonaro himself is currently in a US hospital where he's being treated for abdominal pains, something he suffered from in the past as a result of a near-fatal knife attack during the 2018 presidential election campaign. He has denied inciting his supporters and condemned the invasion of public buildings. Earlier, I caught up with our correspondent Katie Watson in Brazil's biggest city, São Paulo.
Well, I'm actually by the camp that's being dismantled in Sao Paulo outside the military barracks here, because it's not just Brasilia that had these camps. They were across the country. Police arrived about 4 hours ago. It was relatively quiet. People were packing up begrudgingly, I have to admit. There's a lot of anger here, even though there's calm and the calm has restored to the country. I think that the political division, that anger has not gone away. There are probably 30 people who are watching on behind a police cordon, very angry with the Brazilian flag, which has become so associated with far right here in Brazil, and they're not giving up their fight. They really believe that they should be allowed to be here and are very angry about being made to move on.
And what action will we see against the rioters and indeed those who fail to stop them?
Well, I mean, they've been given 24 hours to clear out. The tricky thing is there are accusations that authorities have been siding with some of these protesters or have at least been sympathetic in their views towards them. And I think that's going to be the biggest challenge that Lula, the president, faces, because, you know, this is such a divided country. Jair Bolsonaro had the security forces, the armed forces, a lot of them were on his side when he talked so much about security and safety in this country. I think, you know, moving on and trying to get past and also have a post-mortem on exactly what happened and how it could have happened in Brasilia is going to be the biggest challenge. But certainly, I mean, the political division is not going anywhere. They're still very angry with what's happened. And in fact, they're even blaming the left. I spoke to several people here who said the people who infiltrated, the people who were violent in Brasilia were not from the right. They were not Bolsonaro supporters. Those were the left. And so we're carrying on with this political discourse even after what we've seen in the last 24 hours.
Katie Watson in Sao Paulo. And as we record this podcast, the US President Joe Biden has just invited the Brazilian President Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva to visit Washington in early February.
Authorities in Brazil have ordered the arrest of two security officials accused of colluding with rioters who attacked government buildings in the capital. Over the weekend, thousands of supporters of former far-right President Jair Bolsonaro vandalized the Congress, Supreme Court, and presidential offices in Brasilia. They were spurred by false claims from the former president that his re-election loss was due to fraud. NPR's Carrie Kahn reports.
Brazil's newly inaugurated president, Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, didn't mince words. Speaking to a group of governors at his heavily damaged presidential offices, he said keeping the government safe last Sunday was the job of the state police, and they failed to do so.
A polícia de Brasília negligenciou. A inteligência de Brasília negligenciou.
The police in Brasilia was negligent. The Brasilia police's intelligence was also negligent, said a visibly angry Lula. He went on to accuse state officers of even colluding with the demonstrators. More than 1,000 people have been detained for participating in the attacks on Brazil's Supreme Court, Congress, and presidential offices. Yesterday, hundreds were released for humanitarian reasons, while hundreds more were formally charged. Yesterday, the head of security in Brasilia was ordered arrested. Anderson Torres, a Bolsonaro ally, had already been fired right after the riots. The newly appointed head of security, Ricardo Capelli, says Torres deliberately sabotaged Brasilia's police force.
Foi da falta de comando. Foi uma operação estruturada de sabotagem.
He told CNN Brazil that just after days on the job, Torres gutted the leadership and then quickly went on vacation to the U.S. In a tweet, Torres denied any wrongdoing. He called the accusations of collusion absurd. Authorities say they've identified businessmen from around the country who helped finance the attacks, specifically chartering buses to bring rioters into Brasilia. At least 80 buses arrived in the capital last weekend, packed with Bolsonaro supporters. Natalia Viana is an investigative journalist who monitors social media and the right wing in Brazil. She says rioters openly discussed traveling en masse to the capital. State officials had to have seen the communications, she says.
It is impossible that they did not know. And this is why we're not talking only about omission or incompetence. This is negligence, and it may be criminal. They may have concurred on the acts that happened.
She says organizers used coded messages urging people to come to Selma's party in the capital, a play on words for a military call to action, and that they were hoping five corns would attend. The word for corn in Portuguese is similar to the word for millions. Meanwhile, at the vandalized buildings, workers continue trying to clean up the damage. At the presidential offices, nearly every first floor window of this glass-encased building was smashed. High-pressure water guns are used to pry shards out of the peripheral stone pathways. President Lula's spokesperson, José Crispiniano, scoffs at the notion that the rioters dared to drape themselves in the flag and call themselves patriots.
It was very irrational and very misguided in the sense that they were destroying Brazilian history and Brazilian symbols.
One treasure, a mid-20th century desk used by the first president to work in Brasilia, was tossed out a third-story window. The damage caused by the rioters is still being tallied. Carrie Kahn, NPR News, Brasilia.
Guilherme Casaroy is a professor of political science at the Getulio Vargas Foundation. It's a think tank, and he joins us from Sao Paulo. Guilherme, good morning to you.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
There was a commentator on Brazilian television who said that if there was no invasion of the U.S. Capitol, there would be no invasion in Brazil. How much of what you saw on Sunday reminds you of what happened 2 years ago on January 6th at the U.S. Capitol?
I would even go as far as to say that if Trump hadn't gotten elected in the United States, Bolsonaro wouldn't have a chance to get elected in Brazil, because it's a far-right wave with lots of transnational connections, lots of emulation. The jargons are the same. The conspiracy theories are very similar. So I think that if you look at the Bolsonaro, the pro-Bolsonaro movement or Bolsonarism, it seems clear that it draws a lot on Trumpism, and because of that, they seem to follow on Trumpism steps very closely. So the impression that I have sometimes is that whenever I look at Brazilian politics, it's like I'm watching a remake of a movie whose ending I already know, because we've seen it in the United States. And it was just a matter of time before it happened, really, because those writers, they have been planning a Capitol-like event since at least September 7th, 2021. That was the moment Bolsonaro really, really could have staged a coup. And according to some media reports, he only didn't manage to stage a full-fledged coup d'etat back on September 7th, 2021, which is, by the way, Brazil's Independence Day, because he had no support from the higher ranks of the military. If he did, he would have staged the coup to remain in power as an autocrat. He tried to do something along the same lines in 2022 on Brazil's Independence Day, but then it was too close to elections, and Bolsonaro decided to follow the electoral path, even though he's been challenging the elections, the validity, the integrity, and everything. Bolsonaro decided to take a chance and run in a democratic context, right? But still, I think that Bolsonaro and his supporters have always been very ambiguous and sometimes hostile to democracy and to democratic institutions. So I'd say that that's very similar to what we saw in the United States, but with a twist, because Brazil has a very recent past of military dictatorship. So if there's one thing that distinguishes Brazilians and Americans in this regard is some Brazilians' love for militarism. So there's this, the armed forces play a very important role in people's collective mindsets. The military, they are seen as honest and as highly professional, as patriots. And they have very often interfered with Brazilian politics or Brazil's political life. So that's the reason why I think that in Brazil, the storming of the public buildings could have led to a coup if the factors were all put together.
Very briefly, when you say that he's not committed to democracy, you mentioned the dictatorship, which only ended, 38 years ago in Brazil. How fragile is democracy in the country right now?
Yeah, that's the million-dollar question right now. We don't know exactly how fragile Brazilian democracy is.
Are you worried about it?
One thing that we know is that I am, but one thing that we know is that, well, democracy in Brazil has been very resilient ever since Brazil became a democracy again in 1985. What I mean by this is that we went through a long period of hyperinflation. We went through two presidential impeachment trials. We went through a terrible economic crisis between 2015 and 2017, and yet the Brazilian democracy survived. So I'd say that we have resilient institutions. We have a Supreme Court that has been able to do its job. Institutions are resilient, but I don't want to see them being tested year in, year out. The fact that they are strong doesn't mean that we have to keep trying to break them, right? But the feeling that I have is that thanks to Lula's swift response after the Sunday events, across the world, world leaders are taking Lula as the guardian of Brazilian democracy, right, which happens to be a good thing because it means that Lula will have a lot of international support to make sure that democracy in Brazil is preserved.
Guilherme, it's good to talk to you again. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you for the invitation.
Guilherme Casaroy is professor of political science at Getulio Vargas Foundation. He was in Sao Paulo.
The Cal's Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Thursday, January 12, 2023. So I have been told this is our Katherine Massey Book Club debut study session, Mário Filho's The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. I picked this book way before all of the terrorism and hooliganism in South America. The past few days, we were supposed to be reading this book just to honor and really to learn about Brazil and the great Pelé. Hey, he was voted the athlete of the century, beat out Muhammad Ali, Jackie Robinson, Michael Jordan, all the other folks that you want to name and think of over that time period, Jack Johnson, even if you want to go way back, beat them all out. We should know about this guy. He just passed away at the age of 82. I have heard many, many, many victims of white supremacy over the years say, hey, I've always been intrigued about Brazil, want to go to Brazil, want to learn more about Brazil, think that's an area that we need to study with regards to replacing white supremacy with justice. Most of the time, I do not hear people follow that by, hey, check out this book. Now we will at least be able to add one book to the list, The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. This will be big time stretching our brain computer because this book was translated to English from Portuguese by Jack A. Trapper, white man, and he is a scholar of Portuguese, Brazilian affairs, Brazilian history, I would suspect. He's still alive in the area of the world known as Missouri, unless I'm misinformed. But I don't know anything about soccer, football. I don't know anything about Pelé. I don't know anything about Brazil. I don't know anything about South America. So, wow, this is so much to learn. And we should be especially motivated given what happened or what is happening there, the parallels to what transpired in the U.S. on January 6th, the confusion. They even talked about they used similar jargon in these two continents to sow all of this disruption. I didn't see a whole lot of black people, dark people, January 6th here in North America, so-called. I didn't see a whole lot of dark people down there in South America the past few days either. Maybe I didn't see the right footage. What context? Some of the same cities and locations that you heard at the beginning, you will hear again as we get started. Wow. Global system of white supremacy, racism, and we started it right in that context because we had news segments from the BBC. We had news segments from The Current, that is Canadian Broadcasting Communications, and then we did have a centerpiece from NPR, National Public Radio, but local, national, global system of white supremacy racism. The great victim of white supremacy, Pelé. I saw a report, a journalist said no one has done more to fight against racism, white supremacy than in athletics than Pelé. Wow. We will keep that in mind because I could think of a number of athletes that I would have thought, what, really? Muhammad Ali and all these, really? Jackie Robinson, as I said, this book was originally published 1947, same year. White people allowed Jackie Robinson to play baseball professionally with whites. With that, white ball games again, we will get started. The Katherine Massey Book Club, Mario Filho's The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer, translated by Jack A. Trapper III, audio segment 1.
The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer by Mario Filho, translated by Jack A. Draper III. Translator's note to the first English edition. Published here for the first time in English, The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer is an astoundingly rich panorama of anecdotes from soccer and daily life in Brazilian society from the early 20th century through the 1960s. The language of Filho's text, the first four chapters published originally in 1947, and the latter two in 1964, is vibrant and surprisingly modern in style, while shifting between more lyrical, epic moments and lighter sections featuring Filho's by turns ironic and sympathetic take on the vicissitudes of the struggle to break down class and racial barriers in the game of soccer. Mário Filho's narrative can also be read as a treatise on the democratization of Brazilian culture in the context of its massification. He emphasizes the importance for those who wish to understand the history of the sport, especially in the decades of the 1920s through 40s, when major class and racial integration occurred among Brazilian soccer teams, of considering the spatialized class divides of the empty lot versus the club field for players, and general admission versus the grandstand for fans. These spatial dualisms paint a picture of a hierarchical society with a large divide between a powerful economic and political elite and the great mass of the remainder of the population. They also echo sociologist Gilberto Freire's division of Brazilian society in its early history into the big house of the master versus the slave quarters. Further, they anticipate Robert Damada's more modern division of Brazilian society into the spaces of street and house, and, in particular, his discussion of Carnival, in which he notes the division of Samba school headquarters into a close equivalent of the grandstands and general admission sections initially featured by Filho here, in the context of soccer. The story of class and racial integration of Brazilian soccer will be a story of the interaction and interpenetration of these spatial dyads simultaneously coded by class and race. Gilberto Freire himself was a great supporter of Mário Filho's writing and wrote a laudatory preface to the 1947 edition of this book. There and elsewhere, Freire described the development of a Brazilian soccer style as a fusion of Dionysian impulses in Afro-Brazilian culture, ludic, irrational forms of individual dance, movement, and improvisation, with the originally Apollonian European sport, focused on more rational team strategy and tactics, to form a unique national hybrid. Without going into a more detailed analysis of Freire's formula, what I would like to emphasize here is that this particular dyad focuses on a distinction between the non-European elements of Brazilian culture on the one hand and European culture on the other, in order to emphasize a kind of national synthesis or unity of Brazilian soccer identity. The key point being that difference with regard to Brazilian soccer and related culture and social relations is projected externally. However, the reader of The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer will find a fascinating dialectic play out, which is more focused on internal difference within Brazilian sports and society. This includes, first, the increasingly multi-class and multi-racial playing field, as class and color lines are overcome by poor, working class, and black players. The emphasis here is less on the production of the Freirean hybrid, mestizo, or mulatto. Identity of the team, or the nation, and more on the story of economic, social, and psychological struggle involved in the desegregation of soccer for black players over the course of several decades. A struggle I have analyzed in more detail elsewhere. Second, Filho explores internal differences of identity and playing style even among black Brazilians themselves, perhaps best epitomized by his contrasting portrayal of two soccer giants of the 1930s, Domingos Leguia and Leonidas da Silva. Both Afro-Brazilian players, the former a defender and the latter a striker, are discussed in tandem by Chapter 4 by Filho in terms of their differing temperaments, mindsets, and playing styles. On the other hand, Guia is a rather phlegmatic, fastidious defender, delivering precise and intelligent passes from the back line, all without breaking a sweat. Silva, on the other hand, more closely matches the paradigm of the creative Brazilian dribbler and scorer, moving to the tune of samba with an Afro-Brazilian swing, or ginga, which Pelé would only come to epitomize two decades later, as detailed in Chapter 6. Filho's portrayal of different players like these two emphasizes the diversity within the community of black players itself. Departing from this emphasis on internal difference, his larger tale of black Brazilians and how they helped define the national soccer style, even as they struggled against racism, complicates and transcends Freire's more simplistic and homogenizing vision of black players in Brazil. In terms of the Brazilian World Cup teams, this divide between a more serious, calm, collected defender and a more creative, improvisational, emotional attacker would inform virtually all the decisions as to which player would captain the side. More often than not, it would be the Domingos de Guia-like player who would be selected as captain, proving that the English temperament continued to be very much respected and effective for a team leader on the field. Just as Domingos de Guia himself was very much a Brazilian and Afro-Brazilian player, despite not matching the iconic stylistic model later perfected by Pelé, a solid defensive line would become a far less lauded but essential part of all Brazil's World Cup champion teams. Thus, Filho's focus on these two players in the era of the 1930s when Brazilian soccer fully racially integrated and went professional, paints a picture of a balance between the Apollonian, and the Dionysian in the Brazilian game. This balance would prove fundamental to Brazil's astounding success on the global stage. Not only that, but we see in Filho's history that black players, and to a more limited extent, black coaches, were contributing to all sides of the game, from the tactical approach to making offense and defense come together on the field, to the individual improvisation and creativity, the samba, on the soccer field, for which they would become most famous. Thus, it is quite prescient when Filho writes in Chapter 4 that Leonidas and Domingos are the symbols of Brazilian soccer. In closing, a few general notes about my translation. Every translator must make innumerable choices in a work as extensive as this. Here, I will emphasize that I have attempted to preserve as much as possible Filho's colloquial syntax and punctuation. Filho's free-flowing journalistic style is one key way in which he enables himself to quickly jump between the viewpoints of players, coaches, fans, club presidents, management, and even presidents of Brazil. In addition to his own perspective and that of the larger Rio de Janeiro and national media he was a part of, and the international media he became familiar with when Brazilian clubs or national teams traveled abroad. Finally, it should be noted that Filho peppers his text with English terms, reflecting his understanding of soccer or football as an import of English football, which Brazilians would gradually make their own. When it seems particularly relevant, I have indicated with italics that a term is in English, in the original text, especially earlier in the narrative, in order to highlight Filho's own emphasis on the greater English influence in the first decades of the sport's history in Brazil. I have not done this in every case purely as a stylistic choice to avoid the redundancy of repeated italicization of the same English words many times throughout the book, where Filho uses other languages besides his native Brazilian Portuguese, such as French or Spanish, I have reproduced the language in the original with an English translation in a footnote. Furthermore, for any poems, chants, or songs cited by Filho, I have done my utmost to reproduce the original Brazilian Portuguese rhyme schemes in the English translation. Lastly, in the remainder of this book, any bracketed words in the notes are my own, while the rest are translated from the original. Jack A. Draper III, Columbia, Missouri, 2020. Author's note to the second edition. The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer, the first edition of which went out of print years ago, was an essay that, although it insinuated more than it concluded and sought, above all, to outline the process, in some ways painful and long, of the democratization of Brazilian soccer, came up against a test to which few books are submitted while in print. It's enough to recall that the defeat of Brazil in 1950 in the World Championship of Soccer brought about a recrudescence of racism. The black man was blamed for the disaster of July 16. Thus, apparently, the black man in Brazilian soccer, in a superficial reading, assumed an optimistic perspective with respect to racial integration that had not yet been realized in soccer. Without a doubt, the widest field that had been open to the social ascension of the black man. The proof would be in those sacrificial lambs that were singled out, coincidentally all black: Barbosa, Juvenal, and Bigode. The whites on the Brazilian side were not accused of anything. It is true that Brazilians called themselves, excoriating themselves, in that moment, a sub-race. We were a race of mestizos, a sub-race incapable of overcoming a setback. But Brazilians unconsciously idealized an idol in the image and semblance of Obdulio Varela, El Gran Capitan, evidently an Uruguayan mulatto. If Brazil had become world champion, as we all expected in 1950, the national idol would be, naturally, as it always had been, a mulatto or a black man. The first was named Arthur Friedenreich, son of a German father and a black mother, a mulatto with green eyes. The second, Leonidas da Silva, son of Portuguese father and a black mother, a mulatto closer to black with an upturned nose. When Brazil won the Sweden World Cup in 1958, Brazil chose two idols, the black Pelé and the mulatto Garrincha. The black man in Brazilian soccer supported this proof without having to change a word. The curious thing is that almost the same length of time had separated the choice of a national idol of Brazilian soccer, 19 years between Friedenreich and Leonidas, and 20 years between Leonidas and Pelé and Garrincha. It is striking that without having to modify anything that I wrote, preserving intact the four parts of the first edition of The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer, the second edition arrives, expanded and with the pretension of being definitive. Few people realize how much is demanded of a soccer player. He has to represent a club, a city, a state, the nation. What is expected of him is that he embody the best virtues of man. In the case of the Brazilian, the best virtues of the Brazilian man. When the Brazilian accused Barbosa, Juvenal, and Bigode, he accused himself. Soccer would not be the passion of the people if the people did not identify with a team, their team, with a flag and a shirt. Soccer fans are linked irredeemably to their teams, for better or worse, for happiness or for disgrace. At heart, fans want the players to be better than themselves. The players represent them, represent their club, their city, their state, their nation. The defeat of the player is the defeat of the fan. The ones who lost in 1950 were the Brazilians, more so the ones who didn't play than the ones who did. It is easy to imagine the pressure exerted on the player, white, mulatto, or black, more so on mulattoes and blacks, tied to the racial mixture out of which the Brazilian is molded. Soccer unleashes a struggle between clubs, which is its everyday existence, to the point that this struggle was called a war. The player was the soldier, the cannon fodder, although some were generals, gods of these battles. Many a player succumbed to that permanent tension, true stress. One chapter added to the black man in Brazilian soccer gives it new dimension. The other concerns the whitening of the black man in the clubs that defend him. A black man on the Fluminense team is not black for Fluminense. He is treated like a white man. He can forget about his color and say, like Robson, I used to be black, and I know what that's like. In reality, black soccer players sought, as they rose through the ranks, to be less black. Even forgetting to remember, in some cases, that they were black, having their hair straightened, getting plastic surgery, fleeing from their color. Thus, the importance of Pelé, the king of soccer, who made a point of being black, not to offend anyone, but to ennoble his mother, his father, his grandmother, his uncle, the family of poor black folks that prepared him for glory. No black man in the world has contributed as much to sweeping away racial barriers as Pelé. He became the greatest idol of the most popular sport on earth. Those who clap for him clap for a black man. For that reason, Pelé didn't have his hair straightened. He is black, like his father, like his mother, like his grandmother, like his uncle, like his siblings. To ennoble them, he ennobles the black man. For this reason, he is more than black. He is the black man. Other black players of Brazilian soccer recognize him as such. To them, he is the Negro. I am certain that the black man in Brazilian soccer is enriched by these current additions, and that, belonging to it by right, they complete the book, giving it a definitive form. Mário Filho, Rio de Janeiro, 1964. Author's note to the first edition. The black man in Brazilian soccer did not, to be sure, cost me merely the 5 months I spent writing it. Since 1942, when I began a daily column in O Globo, which I named On the Front Line, I was preparing myself, unknowingly, of course, for the work presented here in this volume. This is what allowed me to realize this goal. I managed to study, separately, various eras of Brazilian soccer, or better yet, a carioca soccer, whose history does not differ in essence from that of any other great sporting center in Brazil. Here, the knowledge of sources was invaluable to me, sources who otherwise would have remained unknown. With each front line reliving a past almost dead, even in the memories of those who had experienced it, I was placing myself before characters in a history that had been written before it was irrevocably lost. Soccer today fills the pages of the most austere, less sports-focused press. This was not always the case, however. It's enough to look over collections of newspapers and magazines from 30 or 40 years ago. Soccer was only interesting to the papers after it became a passion of the people. As long as it did not fill the fields, did not divide the city into groups, real clans, soccer barely existed for the newspapers. For this reason, consulting newspapers up until 1910 serves at most to provide statistics of match results. Only after 1910 is it that soccer, now a journalistic subject, allowed for fans of the so-called British sport, each one with its own club, to write columns, sometimes signed with initials. Marcos de Mendonca did me the courtesy of loaning me his album, the most complete repository of soccer events from 1910 to 1919, with precious photographs, clippings from newspapers, at times 10 clippings from different papers about the same game. Marcos de Mendonca's album served me well, principally to trace what I would call the history of the importance of soccer. An importance that one senses growing in these clippings and photographs, the debut of Marcos de Mendonca in 1910 in a game between Haddock Lobo and Fluminense, rated a quarter of a column. In less than 3 years, the newspaper was giving a page to a simple game. The album also furnished me with names, presenting a number of protagonists whom I could consult. Protagonists who experienced, who should remember what had happened in those times. I sought them out one by one. None of them refused to give me information. On the contrary, they all made themselves available to collaborate with me. Guilherme Pastor, who was preparing a history of Bangu, which he had seen founded, Flavio Ramos, a co-founder of Botafogo, Emmanuel Sodre, another Botafogo founder, who followed closely the life of Caracal. The club of the Lions Square Boys, the same boys who became 1910 champions. Norman Hime, from the early days of Botafogo, Afonso de Castro, the archive of Fluminense, Alfredo Kohler, founder of America, Lux de Mendonca, founder of Catet, a Haddock Lobo, and colleague of Belfort Duarte. Among those who worked the hardest for the merger of America and Haddock Lobo, which gave to America its field, Gastão Cruz, who was there when soccer was the required recreational activity at the São Vicente de Paulo High School, Gabriel de Carvalho, who received a slap from Abelardo de Lamar, a slap that broke up the Metropolitan League, Marcos de Mendonca, symbol of an era of Caracas soccer, Alberto Borgert of Rio, of Fluminense, leader of the movement that brought Flamengo to soccer, Joaquim Guimarães, a fan with a Flamengo ribbon in his hat, who would flirt on a little balcony on Voluntarios de Patria Street, and while flirting would watch Botafogo play every afternoon. Dio Cenzano, Ferreira Gomez, Dow of Correio de Manha newspaper, a fly, as they used to say, in Flamenga's garage. Mario Polo of Fluminense yesterday and today, one of the first newspaper columnists to receive the assignment of writing about soccer. Harry Welfare, the Yankee in King Arthur's court, a true English soccer mission in Brazil. Pedro da Cunha, a fan since that era, who never misses a match. Hugo Fracorelli of the Palmeiras Athletic Association of 1915, the club that made a point of being in Sao Paulo, what Fluminense was in Rio, white and sophisticated. Paulo Canongia, the Caracao representative who would embarrass players from the other small clubs, the poor whites, the mulattoes, and the blacks, at the moment of signing the match ledger. Orlando Bandiera Vilela, who helped to cart sand to the plot of Andaria's field, who experienced the life of Plaza 7 and knew Monteiro up close. Jose da Silva Filho, Loza and Andaria youth product, Jose Tricoli, a Bangu youth product, Luis de Meneses, the Infant Gate of Botafogo, Arnaldo Ginle, the patron of Fluminense, a kind of Prince of Wales of the Brazilian sport, Max Gomes de Pava, who ended up with the archive of Belfort Duarte, Agostinho Forte Filho, the Dada of Fluminense, a high-class player, always mischievous on the field, Mario Reis, who remembers everything that happened in Caracas soccer since 1916, capable of telling you the lineups, the referee, and the score of each game without consulting a newspaper, just pulling from memory. Paulo and João Gola Neto, boys, when on Sundays the Fluminense players would get together at the Coelho Neto's house. Ana Amelia, the fan who would wear the same dress till the day of defeat. The dress she was wearing first on the day of an America victory and later the day of Fluminense victory. João Santos, the president of America, who brought Manteiga to Campos Sales Field. Igas de Mendonca, married to a Borges woman. The Borgish woman demanding that their boyfriends, fiancés, and husbands leave America with Manteiga on the team. Jaime Barcelos, who led the America team in 1922 and 1928. Osvaldo Melo, the prince of passes, who was not ashamed to play beside Manteiga. Adamar Martins, the Japanese of Flamengo, champion of 1920 and 1921. Jaime Guedes, from the first days of Vasco in soccer. Alvaro Nascimento, chronicler of Vasco. Antonio Campos, president of Vasco, who almost went bankrupt because of Vasco. Claudio Nor Correa, the balloon, champion of 1923. Pascoal, champion of 1923 and 1929, Horacio Werner, who brought Pascoal to Rio de Janeiro, changing his name from Pascoal Sinelli to Pascoal Silva, Vicente Caruso, who went to Fluminense with Nilo Martino Brago and managed to experience up close life on Alvaro Chavez Street in 1924. Year of the birth of Amia and the renaissance of white soccer. Reese Carneiro, one of the most active members of the Union Commission in Amia. Oscar Costas, president of the Brazilian Sports Confederation, which made a point of sending a national side to Buenos Aires in tuxedos. Luis Vinhas, who led the São Cristóvão team to conquer the championship in 1926. Castelo Branco, all his life, director of the Confederation. Antonio Avalar, many times president of America. Fabio Horta, who received notes from Floriano, the marshal of victory, on the back of a picture asking for money. Jose Pereira Peixoto, Vasco player who saved welfare from a Jaguare knife attack. Togo, Renan Suarez, Bangu coach in the era of Colonel Pedrosa when Domingos began to draw attention. Silvio Pacheco, who punched Leonidas in 1932 and refused to play with Leonidas on the side. Oscarino, the Pai de Santo of the Rio Branco Cup of 1932. Ivan Maras, the only amateur from Fluminense who didn't hesitate to sign his contract as a professional soccer player. Basto Padilha, the president of Flamengo, who brought the best black players in Brazilian soccer to Gavea. Rivadavia Correa Meyer, an old Botafogo player, president of AMIA in the year of the split, today president of the Brazilian Sports Confederation. Gustavo de Carvalho, the Flamengo president, who fought with Leonidas. João Liro Filho, president of the National Sports Council, who tried to make peace between Gustavo de Carvalho and Leonidas. Roberto Pedrosa, who came to seek out Leonidas for Sao Paulo. Domingos, Leonidas, and Valdemar, who related their lives to me. José Scassa, a journalist who was shortly after the World Championship, Leonidas' secretary. Liete de Castro, head of the Department of Social Assistance of the Metropolitan Federation. José de Almeida, head of the Technical Department of Fluminense, who shared with me the riches of the greatest Brazilian sports archive. And countless more directors, players, and fans. The official documents showed me that true history is written in another way. Whoever peruses the books of AMFA from 1906 to 1923 and from 1924 to 1932, which were twice put at my disposal by the president of the Brazilian Sports Confederation, Rivadavia Correa Meyer, in addition to the sports, in addition to the reports of the confederation itself, would not discover in any part anything about the struggles of the black man, without going into the facts in intimate detail. The minutes, the correspondence of the clubs does not speak of black. The laws of these entities do not touch upon, even lightly, the question of race. They limited themselves to raising social barriers, prohibiting manual laborers, subaltern domestics, office boys, waiters, barbers, low-ranking soldiers, and the like, from playing soccer in affiliated clubs. I went along, bit by bit, lifting the veil, hearing from here, from there, reconstituting the oral tradition, much richer and much more alive than what is written in official documents, serious, circumspect, and more than the newspapers, which don't tell the whole story. Today, they say a lot of things without saying anything at all. The more gossipy press, wanting to get into the lives of players to satisfy the curiosity of a larger and larger audience for soccer, has been around less than 20 years. And this press I had at my fingertips, the complete collection of Vida Esportiva, Sporting Life, a magazine that was born in 1916 and died in 1920, and of Critica, Critique, from 1928 to 1930. O Globo, the Globe, the Journal de Sports, Newspaper of Sports, and O Globo Esportiva, the Sporting Globe. I preferred, however, to hear from directors, players, and fans. I heard from hundreds of them, from every era of Brazilian soccer. When I could hear it from the horse's mouth, I didn't look for anybody else. I assembled in this way material of such caliber that it surprised someone whose opinion I greatly respect. The material was so great and in such detail that it raised a doubt, the doubt of how I could manage to assemble it, catalog it, and use it in a coherent narrative without a gap, without interruption. Would I make use of the imagination of a novelist who had not yet written a novel? No, I didn't use my imagination. No historian could have taken more care than I in selecting the data, in determining its veracity through exhaustive consultations. At times, a simple doubt made me dispense with a chapter, requiring of me further work and research. One vanity I have, that of presenting a work that defies contestation. If I had exaggerated, let alone twisted the facts, there would be no lack of those who would contradict me. Before its release as a book, The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer had the widest journalistic exposure that one could hope for. Since it was published daily over 5 months in O Globo, the newspaper with the greatest circulation in the Brazilian press, and not one refutation arose from anyone, although almost all the protagonists of the history of Brazilian soccer are alive and have read the pages gathered in this volume, which proves that what is here is the truth, pure and simple. Mário Filho, Rio de Janeiro, 1947. Chapter 1, Nostalgic Beginnings, Part 1. There are those who believe that soccer of the past is what was good. Once in a while, we run into one of these nostalgic folks. They're all white, none black. It was something that intrigued me initially. Why is the nostalgic always white? The nostalgic always being white, never black, raised some doubts. And then the golden era chosen by the nostalgic was an era that one could call white. One would see light-skinned, very white players, even blonde players on the teams at times, English or German, few with dark skin and hair. Mulattoes and blacks were a rarity. One here, one there, they were lost in the crowd, not drawing any attention. One knew who was black and who was white. Blacks and whites were not confused. Bangu could put a black player on the team, although it was a club of Englishmen, so much so of Englishmen that it included the, it was the Bangu Athletic Club. The Industrial Progress Company of Brazil, a Brazilian textile factory with Portuguese capital, had sent to find masters in England. The English masters founded the Bangu Athletic Club. One of them, John Stark, a master of printing, lent the house in which he lived, number 12 Estevam Street, for the ceremony of the founding of the club. The founders of Bangu were 9, 7 Englishmen, 1 Italian, and 1 Brazilian, white. Thus, Bangu was born almost completely English. It's true that the director of the factory was Brazilian. He gave the name to the celebrated street along Bangu's field, the ground of Ferrer Street, or the pleasant field of Ferrer Street, as the columnists of the era would write. João Ferrer was there to prevent Bangu from becoming an exclusively English club. And even if he weren't there in order to make Bangu the factory club, for the masters and the workers, the Englishmen of Bangu were not so many that they could imitate the example of Paysandu Cricket Club and Rio Cricket and Athletic Association. At Paysandu and Rio Cricket, it was the same thing, just that one was in Rio and the other in Niterói. At most, they were clubs restricted to Englishmen and the sons of Englishmen. At Rio Cricket, there was no question. It was much more restricted than Paysandu. Still, a Brazilian could manage to play for Paysandu in the final days of soccer at the club, that is, in the middle of the Great War, when the Englishmen and their sons were departing to fight for England, like Sidney Pullen. We sent to Buenos Aires one Paysandu player, Sidney Pullen. He had been born in Brazil. He was Brazilian. The Argentinians did not believe that a Brazilian player could have such an English name, with a face all the more English. It was necessary to produce his birth certificate and all his documents. Shortly thereafter, before the Argentinian's doubts had been entirely put to rest, Sidney Pullen left for England as an English soldier. With the Englishmen and Englishmen's sons being called up, enlisting themselves in the British Army, Paysandú had no other remedy. They opened up an exception for Candido Viana. Candido Viana had been playing as a back for a while on Botafogo's second team, but he was a sports columnist writing for the journal Do Comercio, newspaper of commerce. As a sports columnist, he had free entry to Paysandú, and Paysandú needed a back. A happy coincidence, Viana was at the service of Paysandú. So, Paysandú had on its team, which was on the verge of disbanding, a Brazilian player who was not the son of an Englishman. Rio cricket, never. We can find on Rio cricket in 1914, naturally amidst the Englishmen, a German or the son of a German. The Germans, however, were white like the Englishmen, and blonde. There was no talk of war. The Englishmen got along well with the Germans. When they got together, they didn't feel so foreign. Paysandú and Rio cricket were bits of England transplanted to Brazil. On sunny Sundays, the English flag would flap in the wind, high up on its pole, one on Paysandú Street, the other in Icariai. The collection of newspapers is there. All one has to do is look up the lineups of the Paysandú and Rio cricket teams. These lineups must have been torture for the authors and proofreaders, for the readers too, the majority of whom didn't know a bit of English. Having to spell the names of the 11 players on Paysandú, the 11 players on Rio cricket. Paysandú with a Cruikshank, C.T. Cruikshank, the first and middle names reduced to initials. Also an M. Murray, a G. Pullen, an E. Pullen, a T. Treehand, a J. P. Hampshire, an L. Wood, a C. L. Robinson, an L. Yates, and a J. McCullough. Rio cricket was not far behind, with its A. L. Sutfield, its E. A. Tootle, its G. Reither, its T. Moreno, its C. Calvert, its E. Kirby, its L. F. Garten, its F. Slade, its Conrado Mutzenbacher, its F. Miller, and its J. F. Monteith. The names were published in the paper. Those who didn't know the players wondered if there had been any errors in the proofreading. If one day they appeared correctly, the next day they appeared with typos. The Brazilians found it pretty. They tried to imitate the Englishmen. Victor Etchegaray, a not at all Brazilian name, showed up in the lineups as V. Etchegaray, Clito Portela as C. Portela, Horacio de Costa Santos as H. de Costa Santos, Felix Frias as F. Frias. However, there were two Etchegarays, Victor and Emilio. When they played together, some confusion arose, dispelled in the Brazilian manner. There's Victor, there's Emilio. Imported soccer, made in England, had to be translated. And as long as it was not translated or Brazilianized, whoever liked it had to familiarize themselves with English names of players, of everything. On the field, a player with self-regard had to speak in English, or rather, yell in English. The lexicon of the team captain, precisely the one who would yell most on the field, needed to be vast. When a player on his team had the ball and a player from the other team was running up to take it, he had to warn, "Man on you!" When the other team was attacking and he needed to call his players up front, the signal was, "Come back, forwards!" And there was, "Take your man!" and more. There were 11 player positions on a team. Goalkeeper, fullback right, fullback left, halfback right, center half, halfback left, winger right, inside right, center forward, inside left, winger left.
Alrighty. Context of white supremacy. So we finished audio segment number one. We will pick up for me the text that I have. This would be page three. We'll pick up on the paragraph. The referee, Juiz, J-U-I-Z, was the referee transformed into referee. I guess that's how you say it. R-E-F-E-R-I. That's what we'll pick up at chapter three, the very beginning chapter one. In The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer, I learned something already. Approximately a year ago this time, a little over a year ago this time, or a little less, excuse me, a little less than a year ago, about 11 months ago this time, we were reading The Man in the High Castle. I did not know that this is the Black Man, like the Black Man. And I did not know that, but already they have that explained and the detail about the Black Man, talking about the great Pelé, the Black Man in Brazilian soccer. Like, wow, okay, I will say it that way. And even that, the great three-time World Cup champion Pelé can't just be the man in Brazil. The nigger man in Brazilian soccer. And for reals, that is the title of the book in Portuguese. It's Negro, but I mean, you know, Negro, black, same thing. Negro, all same thing. Anywho, Katherine Massey Book Club, first audio segment. The number is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The email untiljustice@gmail.com. Now, I'm no expert on any component, right, of this book. Not on Portuguese, not on South America, not on Brazil, not on Pelé, not on soccer. I mean, just on and on. Mario Filho, the author, like on and on and on. Ignorant about everything here, which is a great opportunity to learn. And I can't emphasize enough, like, man, I've heard so many people, like tons of non-white people say over the year, non-white people who are familiar with counter-racist concepts say, I am interested in Brazil, would like to travel there, or at least learn, do some studying about this part of the world within the system of white supremacy. Great. I rarely, hardly ever hear anyone mention a specific book, documentary to check out, plans to go, pictures from when they went. We had Marquise Treve on the program, went there to live, talked to him extensively, talked to him about this book even. This is an opportunity, and buddy, with the timing, like, wow, just had the passing of Pelé, so many people are talking about his life, victim of white supremacy, and you know what he did to work against racism, and then everything with the election. Again, I picked this book before all of that happened. With all of that and the connections that they're making to white supremacy in this part of the world and calling it terrorism, just wow. Great time to study Brazil, South America in the context of white supremacy, and again, do exactly what they say in school. Do a compare and contrast system of white supremacy in the U.S., system of white supremacy racism in Brazil, differences, similarities. What do you think? great time. All of that said, we are not doing tangents. I have to say that all the time. So this book is translated. We've read books that were not originally published in English on the book club before. They can be a little bit more challenging, especially they're not even talking about this part of the world. So many of us are not experts on South America. I think most of us have not been physically to Brazil. So this is a lot of new information. I suspect a lot of us were not born this part of the 20th century. So we don't speak Portuguese, I suspect, most of us. So lots of learning here. All of that said, that just means pay attention. Might be a good one to have the book kind of read, follow along, take notes, but please no tangents just because you heard them mention oranges. So this is a great time you can get into your story about orange juice. Be talking about the text. Much obliged. Let's see. We'll share a few caller root in, share a few of their notes, and then we'll get some of the folks who dialed in. I'll share my notes as well. Let's see. Book is translated by a white man. One of our investors wrote in, reading one black man in Brazil, the black man in Brazilian soccer. Greetings, Gus. I'm interested to read this book, having played organized soccer as a youth. How about that? Translator's note to the first English edition. I think this is the second book club selection, which is a translation. The other, The Wretched of the Earth by Frantz Fanon, is formerly the worst book ever. Jack A. Draper III, translator, is a professor at the University of Missouri. He appears to be white. I think that is true. Author's note to the second edition. 1. Democratization of Brazilian soccer, defined as indoctrination or introduction of democratic system or principles. Seems a little vague, maybe like the use of the term diversity. Number 2. Defeat of Brazil in 1950. Recrudescence of racism. Black man was blamed. Whites on the Brazilian side were not accused of anything. If Brazil were world champions in 1950, the national idol naturally always had been mulatto or a black man. A mulatto with green eyes, a mulatto closer to black. Quite similar to the racial abuse the black French players receive in the recent World Cup. We just talked about that. Nairobi Thompson. We just talked about that. The English team advanced pretty far as well, and I think their best players were also black, and they got blamed when the team did not win. Happened consistently, and they pointed out how this did not happen with the white players. If they, you know, missed a penalty kick or whatever, gave up a goal or, you know, whatever, they would not be, you know, we got bang on, and particularly not, we're going to pile on and blame them racially. That just does not happen. But yes, that's another reason why. Oof, the timing with this one to be reading this three-time World Cup champion, Pelé, and we just finished up with the World Cup, and to literally like days ago, and to have some of these very same charges around the world. So they're saying this happened in Brazil. We got to blame the Negros. This France, blame the Negros. England, blame the Negros. This all over the world. Come back to that later. Number 3. Whitening of the black man. Fluminense. I'm so glad I don't have to narrate this book. Jesus Christ. Like, I do not speak Portuguese. Have never studied Portuguese. Like, oh my God. Man, I wish they had narrator for this book. Much obliged to our investor in Florida for investing her time and voice to this channel, which I told her, I was like, man, this is a challenging read. Jesus Christ. Fluminense, I think that is. Fluminense, treated like a white man. I got the white part. I used to be black, forgetting they were black. Pelé, the king of soccer, made a point of being black. Didn't have his hair straightened. This reads like the statements of a suspected racist blaming victims of racism, white supremacy. I found all of this fascinating for so many reasons, for so many reasons. Have to share on that in a minute. Continuing, author's note to the first edition, number 1. Books of the AMFA, 1906 to 1923, 1924 to 1932, reports of the Confederation itself, did not discover any part of the struggles of the black man, does not speak of racism or black people. The fact that black males were not mentioned seems not at all surprising. Supposed to happen, and for context, like, it's in my brain computer just because they mentioned it when they were talking about the life and times of Pelé. So they're starting with these different books talking about the history of football, soccer in Brazil, early 20th century. So they're starting in 1906. Formal slavery ended in Brazil in 1888. 1906 soccer teams. So that's, if my puny Negro brain can get this math accurate, what is that, 28 years? 28 years, right? If my math is all right. 1888, 1906. Or it's not even 28 years, it's 16 years. See, couldn't even do that much. I mean, but it's, I mean, that's not, you know, a whole lot of time, at least in my way of thinking. Or it's 18 years. There we go. 18 years. Took me a little bit. I got it. Making me got too much with the Portuguese and everything. 18 years. That's all we're talking about from shackles, right? Selling, institutional rape of black males and females that we read about in recreation of Africa. I mean, I don't know. I don't know. Like, that's not even 20 years. Like, you probably have a whole lot of people who would still be alive who we were in shackles. Black males, like, they've been anally raping us all this time. Like, what do you mean? Of course we're not in a soccer book. Like, what are you talking about? Anyway, let's see. Chapter 1, number 1. Those who believe that soccer of the past is what good is what is good, nostalgic folks all are all white, none black, nostalgic always being white. This is such a common theme in the system of racism, white supremacy, suspected racists longing for the good old days on the plantation. Amen. Like, it reminded me of so much of the, dare I say, MAGA, with all of the comparisons, Trump of the tropics with Bolsonaro and all of that, former President Jair Bolsonaro. But that, so much of the good old days. In fact, my black male victim of white supremacy history professor advisor at TJ's University, UVA, he used to talk about that phrase, the good old days. And he said, for black people, when would that be? And that's what the whole class did. He says, yes, it would have to be white. So even if we move to South America, okay, now we're in Brazil, same question. Yes, the good old days. When would that be exactly? I'm ignorant. I haven't been there, so maybe we'll find out as we read. I'll pause there. Let's see. Folks who dialed in, the number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Also to keep in mind as well, two things, I guess, to keep in mind. Like I said, I've heard lots of folks who say that they would like to study about Brazil and all that. Some CO.W.S. listeners as well. Great opportunity here, and what timing. But Mr. Fuller, right, I've heard him for years. He also has talked about Brazil. Mr. Fuller, who was born in 1929, okay. So, again, formal slavery ends in 1888 in Brazil. Mr. Fuller, born in 1929 in Oklahoma, he said when he was still confused about racism, white supremacy, that he used to think, hey, if all else fails, I can go to Rio. That's, you know, someplace where it's all right for black people. What? Just what? He's a victim of racism. I'm not mocking him at all. I'm just like, WTH, like, slavery just ended here. In 1888, why would anybody think this place would be cool for black people? Like,
no race. Like, why would that's, I just really, because I'd never really considered that before, but like, I have the audio, I'll play it. Like, he mentions Brazil frequently. Mr. Fuller has over there, as do many people. Just, man, the amount of confusion that racists have generated about this area is staggering. Like, I'm just, yeah, I'm just think on that as we proceed. Slavery ended here in 1888. Let us see. Lauren with us. Third book on white ball games in a row. Did you have commentary? Should be with us. I'll check for other hands also.
Yes, sir. I am here. Good evening to you and the listeners. The author's note was pretty long, and I don't know, maybe I missed him to say it could have been more than one of them. But anyway, I'll just start. There was a part, it says, this includes first, the increasingly multi-class and multiracial playing field as class and color lines are overcome by poor working class and Black players. I'm not really sure what that means, and I don't know of any non-white people who have overcome the color line, whatever that metaphor is. But if it's a metaphor for racism, white supremacy, I don't know any non-white people who have overcome that. I appreciated the parts where he was talking about the text and what it's going to mean. Like the italics was, you know, the English and brackets, that's his own words. Maybe that's common, but I appreciate that. There was a couple of words, several, I mean, maybe five or seven that popped up that I wasn't really sure what they meant. So I had to search them. Massification was one of them. Maybe other people know what that word is, but I was not familiar. It means the process of bringing something to a mass audience. Recrudescence, that was another one. That is the recurrence of an undesirable condition. And the phrase recrudescence of racism, that's, I think they were talking about losing a game. And then, yeah, the recrudescence of racism. I hope I'm saying that correctly. Excoriating, I've heard that term, but I did look it up just to make sure I understood, and it means to censure or criticize severely. Irremediably, that word, I had to look that up as well. It means in a manner or to a degree that precludes remedy, cure, or correction. Also, I think this was also during the author's note, he used the term lifting the veil that made me think about Frederick Douglass. I think he said life under the veil, something like that. And it's pretty interesting because he also said he used the metaphor, the color line as well, right? So there was another part, and I think you might have just read it in someone else's the email, but it said the other concerns, the whitening of the Black man in the clubs that defend him, a Black man on the, I'm not sure I'm saying this correctly, Fluminense team is not Black for Fluminense. He is treated like a white man. He can forget about his color and say, like Robson, I used to be Black and I know what that's like. Man. BGQ, that sounds absurd to me. He can forget. Now, I cannot say what another person can or cannot forget, but I don't think I will ever be able to forget my experience being classified as non-white Black. Chapter one, it was a lot of the author's notes, but right there at the beginning of chapter one, first lines of the book, it says, there are those who believe that the soccer of the past is what was good. Once in a while, we run into one of those nostalgic folks. They're all white, non-Black. It was something that intrigued me initially. Why is the nostalgic always white? And I, too,
wrote that down in my notes, and I put, this makes me think of Make America Great Again. When was it great? White people don't typically elaborate on when exactly they mean. I'm not sure if it's when Black people were in chattel slavery. I don't really know. And that's all I have for now. Thank you for letting me speak.
I'm sorry you've had such a difficult existence, but Gus T has overcome the color line. So from now on, you put my name down when you hear that metaphor in use. You tell him, Gus T, little yoga, get some peppermint tea, vegan vittles, overcome. Okay, we almost did Dr. King. How the man put Dr. King on that one? We shall overcome. You can harmonize that one. Put anyway. Much obliged, Lauren. Let's see. The MAGA. I said the same thing. And I actually have heard a few white people be explicit and say the good old days when we could own a Negro. I have heard a number that I think that's even in Borat, where they have some of the young white people. The movie, folks are called the good old days when we could own a Negro. And even they have a lot of those different movies and things like the nostalgia film, Shawshank Redemption. That's not even the one that I thought of, but that would qualify. The Tom Hanks one. The Green Mile. There we go. They have so many of those. Nostalgia, where we can go back and even Back to the Future. We just said, The Help. They got racks of it. I have to look to see what type of films they have other than City of God. I think that's like the only film that I have seen that's about Brazil, other than the anime Rio, which doesn't count, I don't think. Let's see. I'll get to my notes. Keep an eye on the switchboard as well. Let's see. And there are multiple notes. So the translator has a note to the first English edition. There is an author's note to the second edition from Mr. Filho, who is a renowned journalist in Brazil in and of himself. He talked a little bit about that in the book. And then there's a second author's note, or there's an author's note to the first edition. So yes, we that's why it took so long for us to actually get to chapter one, because there are so many of these notes and different editions. And again, this book has been translated, which always, you know, that's another layer of work for the brain computer and more refinement processing to get this final product that we have here. Let's see. All right. My notes starting, so this is from the translator's notes. So this would be Jack A. Draper III, white man at the University of Missouri, Michael Brown Jr. And he's still alive. So, you know, he's someone I guess we could reach out to and chat it up with him if we have questions as we're kind of moving along through the text if folks are interested. So love it, and always encourage folks to look up words as you're reading. If you're not familiar with them, things don't make sense, all that good stuff. It says, the spatial dualisms paint a picture of a hierarchical society with a large divide between a powerful economic and political elite and the great mass of the remainder of the population. Whew, buckets, oh, words, and all that just sounds like you're talking about the system of white supremacy, racism, and I mean, really, keep it plain. If we're talking about time period, early 20th century too, we're just, like I said, 1888 removed from formal plantation, institutional anal rape of black males, rape of black females. Make it plain. I mean, what? We have formal slavery of Negroes, black people, Africans. Call it plain what it is. He continues, they also echo sociologists Gilberto Freire's division of Brazilian society in its early history into the big house of the masters versus the slave. That's what I'm saying. Make it plain. Make it plain. Like, you got to go and quote some, I don't know if this Gilberto Freire, I have to look to see. Sister said, I'm ignorant about all this. I don't know any of these people. I don't know any of these names, the players, any of that. So lots to learn. Have to keep my brain computer active. So then he goes on, he says, this Freire, Freyre, F-R-E-Y-R-E. Himself was a great supporter of Philo's writings. He says, Freyre described the development of a Brazilian soccer style as a fusion of the Dionysian impulses in Afro-Brazilian culture, ludic, irrational forms of individual dance, movement, and improvisation with the originally Apollonian European sport focused more on rational team strategy and tactics to form a unique national hybrid. All of that, same thing, like, wow. Now, that is a lot of word salad, and this isn't even a translation. This is directly from Mr. Draper, his thought process about all of this. And he is quoting from this Gilberto Freyre. I don't know. Like I said, I'm ignorant. I don't know enough about, is this a white person? Is this a white man? Sounds like he would definitely be a so-called Brazilian, but I don't know if he's white or not. But all of this, it has a very sexual component to it. I think most people would not argue that dancing frequently is thought of as sexual, right? All that touching and gyrating and all the rest of it. But just all of this, the metaphors going back to the Greco-Roman white history, the Apollonian Dionysian impulse, like, what? The Negro impulses are irrational. Individual dance and improv, that's what I mean about all that sexual gyrating black man out there. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Whereas the white people, we are rational and we use our brain and we go out here and we have already thought out our strategy to, like, what? What? Darwin's athlete, again, black people are irrational always. Even Cleo Monago says that. That's what I mean. See, that's one of Cleo Monago for years. Black male victim of racism who promotes anti-sex, calls it same gender loving. Same thing they've talked about on the Brazilian slave plantation, institutionally, anally raping black males. Cleo Monago says you can't have a rational conversation with black people. Black people are not rational. Black people are not rational. Racists have been saying that for like centuries. Justification for enslaving and raping, pillaging black people all over the world. They're not rational. White people, we are thinkers, smart. That's why we're in charge. Let's see. Continues. The reader of The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer will find a fascinating dialectic play out, which is more focused on the internal difference within Brazilian sport and society. This includes, first, the increasingly multi-class and multi-racial playing field as class and color lines are overcome by poor working class and black players. This is the one that Lauren mentioned. What? What? Gilberto Freire wrote the report Mulatto Football. We got a big footnote. Let me see. So footnote four with what we just read, this passage, same passage, all this overcoming the color line. Footnote four, the word black in Philo's narrative is generally a translation of one of two Portuguese words, preto or negro, the former referring relatively more to skin color and the latter to ancestry. Now that's important. For the most part, context makes it clear which connotation the author has in mind with any given usage. Philo's usage of the term negro is in accordance with contemporary usage in Brazil, encompassing both individuals he would consider to be purely of Afro-Brazilian descent, purely, whatever that means, and those of mixed race, such as mulattoes. The term he most frequently uses to refer to people of mixed race, whatever that means, with African and European ancestry. Additional racial color terms are glossed below when further clarification is needed. I'll give you the other one since this is such a big, the racial classification confusion in Brazil. We can't even remember. We were talking to Marquise Treve and it was like, we couldn't even, do they have white people in Brazil? They have been saying white all over the place in this book already. It's been no confusion. Yes, there are white people here. The white people are the nostalgic ones. And ooh, the good old days when we had Negras in Brazil and ooh, all that, like, confusion. So this is the other racial classification. This is footnote five. For the translator's note, mestiço is the most general adjective indicating racial mixture in Brazilian Portuguese, more generic in terms of racial mixture than its cognate mestizo in Spanish English, which itself tends to indicate a more specific mixture of European and indigenous ancestry or culture. Jack A. Draper, Reading Race and Gender in The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer and Beyond. So that's his review of the way that these, even that, to have a white man who did a whole review talking about the use of terms, racial classification terms. White people are not ignorant. Okay, so those I thought are two important footnotes. Let me get back to the, will it take me back? I wonder if it will do that. I guess not. I always appreciate having the e-copy of the book because you get the footnotes and you can fly around really easy in the book and what have you to make it convenient to check the footnotes and everything else. Okay, back to that. I share the same sentiment as Lauren. I have no idea what that means in terms of overcoming the color line. I have no idea how you becoming a professional athlete in Brazil, the United States, England, France, anywhere else in the world, particularly if you're classified as black. I have no idea how that means all of a sudden you're no longer black, you've overcome the color line, whatever that means. Even the first part of that, when he says increasingly multi-class and multiracial playing field, like, what? What does that mean? He has the multi-class first. They always get that class confusion thing in there. And then multiracial, as though there's more than one red man. They kill in Brazil. They kill it. They got, even think of that. People think of Brazil. They don't think this is the place in the Western Hemisphere with the greatest population of people classified as black. That's not what people think of. They think this is the place where, oh my God, they have crazy. They got about a billion racial class. That's what people think. They have about a billion racial classifications in Brazil. You can't even figure out what race anybody is. Not this is the place with the highest population of people that racists have designated as black in this hemisphere. Confusion. Let's see. But see, because I don't know, because this is a ball game book. Do you mean a soccer team where white and non-white people are allowed to play? Excuse me, where non-white people are allowed to play? Is that what you mean when you say a multiracial playing field? Or is this that trite old metaphor about we're going to even out the playing field, no racism, no mistreatment, everybody will have a just opportunity? Is that what you mean? Continues. He says, look at this. The emphasis here is less on the production of the Freirean hybrid identity of the team or the nation, and more in the story of economic, social, and psychological struggle involved in the desegregation, that word again, of soccer for black players over the course of several decades, a struggle I have analyzed in more detail elsewhere. Let's see. More often than not, it would be Domingos de Gaia. Probably messing up a whole lot of names. It is super challenging. I do not know Portuguese at all, nor am I familiar with these players. Domingos de Gaia, like player, would be selected as captain, proving that the English, in quotes, temperament continued to be very much respected and effective for a team leader on the field, just as Domingos de Gaia himself was very much a Brazilian and Afro-Brazilian player, whatever that means, despite not matching the iconic stylistic model later perfected by Pelé. A solid defensive line would become a far less lauded but essential part of all Brazil's World Cup champion teams. I guess, like I said, I don't know a whole lot about soccer either, so I guess some of this is talking about stylistic ways of playing soccer that are allegedly different between the way that the black players played and the way that the white players played. I do find it fascinating that they're saying that a part of being a so-called leader out here playing this ball game, you had to be able to speak English. That shows you had the correct temperament, and he got that in quotes, whatever that means. I mean, if people speak Portuguese, they could have just switched and made signals so that everybody understands this. We'll just say this in Portuguese and, you know, no big deal. No. Got to speak it like a white man. It's a white man's game. Whatever that. Goodness, racism dominates everything. Let's see. All right, so moving on to, so this is author's note to the second edition. The democratization of Brazilian soccer came up against the test to which few books are submitted while in print. Now, again, democratization, that word democracy, pops up, gets used all over the world, apparently, to our detriment. And our is non-white people, victims of racism, us thinking that, oh, yes, Brazil is a democracy. No, this is a system of white supremacy, racism, for sure, for sure. I didn't see a whole lot of dark people. I didn't see people out there, Pelé's complexion, burning and looting this week in South America. Maybe I didn't get to see all the footage, so maybe I missed some of it. He says, but democracy, says, it's enough to recall the defeat of Brazil in 1950 in the World Championship of Soccer, brought about by the recrudescence of racism. That was one where I said, man, come on. How you say that in Portuguese? And even recrudescence, recurring, did it leave? Like, in my view, to use this term accurately, racism would have to vacate for a while and then reappear. If it's constant, right? Nobody has overcome. It's here all the time. That's not recrudescence. That's just constant, omnipresent. All areas of people activity and all over the world. That's what we're talking about. Not recrudescence, if that's the correct pronunciation. Then he gets into black males specifically being blamed for the loss. He says the social ascension of the black man. What does that mean? Has that happened in Brazil where they're talking about black male privilege? We talked about that with Marquise Treve last week. The social ascension of the black man? What? What? Let's see. The proof would be in those sacrificial lambs that were singled out. Coincidentally, all blacks, Barbosa, Juvenal, and Bigode, the whites on Brazilian side, were not accused of anything, of course. Let's see, when he's talking about these champions, when he says the first, idol of Brazilian football, Arthur Friedenrich, now I feel like he didn't need to tell us this, if we have some knowledge, but son of a German, duh, with a name like Friedenrich, I don't think this fellow was, from Zimbabwe, I don't think, I could be in error, it doesn't exactly strike me as being a Korean surname, I could be in error, but a German father, and a black mother, cow bell. Now, I mean, that's why I said, hey, we're talking early 1900s, slavery, so-called, just ended in Brazil in 1888. This is the product of rape. Would have to be. Are you telling me? They don't even have a name. We got his father's name, right? We didn't get the father's name. But Arthur Friedenrich, he's got his father's German name. I don't think his black mother would have the last name Friedenrich. I could be wrong. Maybe she was owned and raped by some Germans before, but I mean, a mulatto with green eyes, even that. Now, man, wouldn't that be idolized here even? Matter of fact, our investor, he said that Mahmoud Abdul Rauf had said that his mother, black female, was raped by, he didn't say rape, but he had a white father that he didn't know that, you know, we don't know if that's rape. We don't know what's going on with that. Let's see. Oh, and he said the second Brazilian soccer star, Leonidas da Silva, son of a Portuguese father and a black mother. Now, that's another one. I would think that's rape. White man, black female. A mulatto closer to black with an upturned nose. Now, what does that mean? That's what I would need a picture. You don't have a picture of the up. What? And even that, a mulatto closer to black. Does that mean he's darker? Is that what they're talking about? Preto? That's what they said. Skin color. I think that's Portuguese for darker, more melanin, or they mean something else. And then the upturn, is that a Negro? Is that closer to black, having an upturned nose? For that, woo. Let's see. When Brazilians do all this talking about, they say where soccer would not be the passion of the people if the people did not identify with a team, their team, with a flag and a shirt. Soccer fans are linked irredeemably to their team. The soccer flag for people, I don't know if you've been paying attention, but that has been the subject of many, many news reports because many of Jair Bolsonaro, that is the defeated former president who's in Florida with retired firefighter, that his supporters were wearing the national football team's jerseys to go out and participate in this hooliganism and all the rest of it. And they had Lula's supporters saying, we're going to reclaim that and we're not going to allow them to propagandize the soccer team and all the rest of it. But that's been huge in the news for about a good month or so, probably even more than that. Let's see. White ball games. The racial mixture. Soccer unleashes a struggle between clubs, which is its everyday existence, to the point that struggle was called a war. The player was the soldier, the cannon fodder, although some were generals, gods on the on these battles. Many a player succumbed to the permanent tension, true stress, and he has stress in italics. Man, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing has a whole segment talking about those ball games. I just played the audio when Pelé passed where she said, white people banning ball games, and even soccer is included when they talk about CTE because you got collisions there, and they're banging the ball off of their head and what have you, concussions right there, and just hitting the ground and what have you, got collisions. But Dr. Welsing, she said white people banning ball games would be the same as banning firearms. Never gonna happen. White genetic annihilation. Those ball games symbolically mean way more. And I even already talked about the sexual nature and talking about, ooh, these black players are so innovative in the way that they dance and move. And ooh, come on. In the area where they had institutional rape of black males. Learning as we go. In reality, black soccer players sought as they rose the ranks to be less black. What? Even forgetting to remember in some cases that they were black, having their hair straightened, getting plastic surgery, fleeing from their color, blaming the victim for sure. And I mean, now really, who is to blame for all of that? One, have we not heard this before? Minister Malcolm X, Assata Shakur, have we not heard this before? Yes? Okay. All over. This, if anything, would be another one. Global system of white supremacy racism. You can go all over the world and the same thing, us hating our features, our hair, our complexion, don't want to be black, get back, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing. But all of that victim blaming, practicing racism, white supremacy, I mean, gosh, and why would a black person be encouraged to forget that they were black, if that is even possible? I have no idea. You live in a place where they institutionally rape black people. How do you forget that? Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, did he sound like he forgot growing up starving in Mississippi? The great Bill Russell, since we got some familiarity now with professional Negro professional athletes, did he sound like he forgot what it was like to be a black person? At any point in his life, ever, whatever that would mean, you don't have race soldiers around to remind you, oh, yeah, Negra. Let's see. He can forget his color. If he can forget it, wait, back up, make sure I don't miss it all. The other concerns, the whitening of the black man in the clubs. Fluminense, a black man on the Fluminense team is not black for Fluminense. He is treated like a white man. What? He can forget about his color and say, like Robson, I used to be black and I know what that's like. What? What? What does that, all of that, treated like a white man, break that down for me. What does that mean? Give me all the details. How do you forget, once again, he says it twice, forget about your color. What does that mean? I used to be black. You're not now. You go outside, you take that jersey off, and you're a white man.
Really? I didn't get that impression from the other Negro athletes that we've read about. Wilt Chamberlain, Mike Jordan, $40 million slave. That was not William Roden's conclusion. These guys weren't making nearly the amount of money that, you know, we're talking about these days. I could be wrong. Let's see. And why would a black person, even today, 2023, why do you have black people? Why? Hey, skin lightening creams and all of that stuff, billion-dollar business still, 21st century. Why is that? Still, black get back, brown paper bag test, and all the different manifestations of that all over the world. Why is that? What is that in response to? Non-white people are never to blame for that. We talked about that in President Obama's Dreams from My Father. One of the first books we read, he talks about a black female coming into his office in Chicago and she had blue contact lenses. And then he felt bad because he made her feel kind of guilty about wearing them. And he said, man, the person who is to blame for this, the racist. That's our president said that, Dreams from My Father. Obesers. Let's see. He says the import of Pelé, the king of soccer, who made a point of being black. They have to break that. Maybe he'll explain that as we get through with the early part. So maybe that'll be explained how he made a point of being black, not to offend anyone, but to ennoble his mother, his father, his grandmother, his uncle, his family, poor black folks that prepared him for glory. Like I said, hopefully that'll all be broken down. Because made a point of being black. How would you do, and why would you even need to do that? We can see that you're a Negro. Like, what would that be? I'm black and I'm proud. Did you know I'm black? Negro? Did you know that? Got on it. Let's pay attention. We'll see how it gets explained. They said the club Hugh Fracaroli of the Palmeiras Athletic Association of 1915, the club made a point of being in Sao Paulo. They were mentioned in the report. What the Fluminense was in Rio, white and sophisticated. Paulo Canangia, the Carioca representative who would embarrass players from the other small clubs, the poor whites, the mulattoes, and the blacks, at the moment of signing the match ledger. Like, even that, I thought, because the breakdown, he didn't just say he would embarrass whites. He would poor whites. This sounds like, and I have to get the demographics, but this sounds like another country, so-called, where the white people would be greatly outnumbered. So it might not even be a whole lot of poor white people in Brazil. But we would degrade the poor white people, the mulattoes, and the blacks. If you're just a regular white man, you do not get chained like that. This is only for the poor white people. Racial sacrifice, white sacrifice, mulattoes, non-whites, Negros. Let's see. Anything else? Great points you all made already about black people not being mentioned. Duh, why would that be a surprise? Let's see. All this about the nostalgia you all already talked about. White nostalgia, MAGA, all of that. This part where they go into the Germans' presence on the team, I thought that was so important. Global system. They didn't, you know, we didn't hear problems about the Englishmen, Portuguese, Germans getting along. They have had squabbles, right? They've had whole wars, right? These countries where they didn't always get along throughout history, repeatedly sometimes, right? Unless I've been misinformed. We didn't hear any of that. We're white. We didn't hear, you know, we got to make rules. You got to be native to be on the soccer team, or we got to limit the number of formal. We're not going to have all these Germans on our team. We don't like them too much. You get on out of here, Friedrich, rest of you all, and Portuguese too. Or I guess, well, I don't know. See, but you got to be native. See, you at least got to be South American to be on the team. We're not going to have a whole bunch of these foreign folks coming in here. They do that. They even got those sort of rules today. We didn't hear that. You're white. Come on in. We'll figure it out. Do they all speak, all the white Germans, they all speak English or whatever? They're all multilingual, so we don't have any language barriers or nothing like that. We're white. Everything will work itself out. Is that
Let's see. We got so early. We're like in chapter one. We didn't even get... I guess I can pause there. Because, yeah, we didn't really get very far into chapter one on this. I'll make sure I didn't miss any notes. If folks did not have any additional comments before we push off to the second audio segment, we are so early. They had so many different notes for the translation and then the different editions of this book. Again, this book published in 1947. Like, I don't know. I guess that I'm ignorant about everything. Like I said, I didn't know anything about any component of this book. Soccer, South America, nothing. And so I didn't know that this book was that old, like 1947. And then they've had some updates and what have you to include additional information. But wow. And again, like I said, even that is kind of like, wow, that's the same year as Jackie Robinson, to like be talking about kind of the exact same subject matter. Racists allowing a black male, so-called, to play in athletics, professional athletics that are dominated, controlled by white supremacists. I don't know. Maybe all the talk about Jackie, I have to look at to see the exact date, right, when this book was originally published, because Jackie Robinson, that was global. Like, he was going to play in Canada and all the rest of it. So I'm sure that was talked about all over the world. Baseball was much more popular back then than it is now. So, yeah, I have to look to see, because that definitely could have been a confluence of all of this kind of being talked about at the same time. And then, yeah, I'll have to check and see while we learn. We'll assume folks are good. If you have additional commentary, make a note, and we should have ample time to share once this section concludes. So again, Mario Filho's The Black, or it's The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. We are very, very early in chapter one, Katherine Massey Book Club, audio segment number two.
The referee, juiz, was the referee, transformed into referi, ou refe. The linesman, bandeirinha, was the linesman, and so on. But the names of the players of Paysandu Cricket Club and Rio Cricket and Athletic Association were more difficult to remember. They changed a lot, especially those of Rio Cricket. Englishmen who came for the English Telegraph to Leopoldina spent some time here and afterward left, never to return again. They left and were substituted by others, and Rio Cricket was there with doors open to them. One would leave and another would enter. On the field, one hardly noticed the difference. They seemed the same. Bangu could not count on any Englishman arriving from England. They were all spoken for with guaranteed spots on Paysandu or Rio Cricket. The English colony of Bangu, a long way out, isolated, one might say, was small. How many masters did the Industrial Progress Company of Brazil have? For this reason, Bangu was never a closed club in the sense of Paysandu or Rio Cricket, at least in soccer. Indeed, in cricket, the Englishman refused any talk of mixture. Even a white Brazilian couldn't make it on a cricket team. What is more, Brazilians were never much for cricket, a game good for an Englishman. The players pad themselves wearing something close to medieval armor in order to wield their bat. In addition, the ball was made of wood, covered in leather. If it hit the leg of a player, it could break it. It would begin in the morning at 9 o'clock and continue into the afternoon, sometimes all the way till 5 o'clock. If it was winter, it would be getting dark, and it would stop every half hour, or the players and fans would drink whiskey. One break was longer than the others, that for lunch. The bar would fill up. The English would drink, eat sandwiches, laugh, and sing, beating a rhythm with their glasses. Before installing the field, according to a very English precaution, they installed the bar. Once the bar had been built was when the English and Bangu could think about the field. There was a garden at the factory, a wide lawn of English grass that would make Bangu's field the greenest, the softest of Karakai fields. the garden, the so-called gold bars, on one side, and the other would serve as the field, so long as grass was not planted on the neighboring piece of land, separated from the factory by a wall, and where the trash was disposed of. The trash was manure, and of the highest quality. The grass quickly consumed it and spread out, covering the field of bamboo in green. On cricket days, one could see only Englishmen scattered across the field and in the bar. On soccer days, it was another story. The workers would hang around to see many whites, mulattoes, and blacks, also with a desire to kick the ball. All that it took was for the ball to go out of bounds, as it did ever so often, for the workers to run after it like boys running after a Sao Joa balloon. Later, the impression ceased to be this, of boys after Sao Joa balloon, and became that of boys after an actual ball. Street urchins would show up at any field, in any street, where a game of soccer was being played. But in 1904, the year in which Bangu was born, it was more common to see boys running after a balloon, though only in June, than after a ball all year long. And the English, in order to put together two teams, had to find people to fill in the holes. So much so that when Bangu made its soccer debut, playing a real match against Rio Cricket in Icarai, there were already two Brazilians on the 11, the word used by the more erudite columnists. But those Brazilians were white. One was Luis Gaspar, center half, from right there, a weaver in the factory. The other, Augusto Alvarenga, left halfback, was imported from the city, an employee of the retail part of the business, having nothing to do with the factory. Bangu was 2 months old. It had improvised a team. That team with Luis Gaspar and Augusto Alvarenga would not be the final Bangu team. Bangu was still in formation. Its true team only arose a year later, with five Englishmen, Frederick Jacques, John Stark, William Hellowell, William Proctor, and James Hartley. Three Italians, Cesar Boccellini, Dante De Loco, and Segundo Maffio. Two Portuguese, Francisco de Barros, or Chico the Doorman. A factory guard who was constantly rattling the woodwork, who only saw the ball and nothing else, and Justino Fortes, a giant, the size of William Hellowell, and one Brazilian, Francisco Carigal, a Brazilian with 50% black blood. His father was white and Portuguese, his mother black and Brazilian. Francisco Carigal, maybe because he was Brazilian and mulatto, the only Brazilian and the only mulatto on the team, was a perfectionist in the way he dressed. He was the best-dressed player on Bangu, a real dandy on the field. There's a photograph on this Bangu team, a photo truly worth saving in an album. Friedrich Jacques, master engraver, the goalkeeper, is in the back. Standing between José Vilas Boas, director of sports, and João Ferreira, honorary president of Bangu. João Ferreira is in all white, his white clothes and white collar blending together with his white chest covering and white tie. He looked like a nurse. José Vilas Boas is in a pale gray at the top, reserved. One looks at the photograph and sees only mustaches, droopy mustaches, just like that of Friedrich Jacques. Rolled mustaches, like that of José Vilas Boas, twisted mustaches, like that of João Ferreira. Only three players did not wear mustaches. The doorman, Justino Fortes, the Englishman, William Hellowell, with a very white face, without a wisp of peach fuzz, smooth and soft like the face of a boy, and the Brazilian, Francisco Carigal. Cesar Boccellini's mustache was quite Italian, a daring little mustache with fine tips pointed upward. That of Francisco de Barros, Chico, the doorman, was not daring at all. On the contrary, it was an austere mustache, weighted down with the responsibility of a father of a family with many children, while that of John Stark gave him, helped by his mild air, the face of a bird dog, good and friendly. And then there was the mustache of Dante De Loco, well-trimmed like that of Segundo Maffio. That of William Proctor was black, darkening his face. That of James Hartley was blonde, almost white, making him look older. Also, James Hartley already had thinning hair. The Bangu shirt was not like it is today, knit and tight-fitting, with broad stripes in red and white. It had very thin stripes, almost touching, and it had a neck more like a soft collar, at least like one of these collars today, whose design comes from sports shirts. The fabric was a bit silky and brilliant, like muslin. Not all the shirts were the same. Some had right in the center, running from top to bottom, bars of the same cloth with horizontal stripes. Wide bars, the thickness of a fist. Skinny bars, the thickness of a finger. The English didn't pay much attention to these details. They were less careful in their manner of dress than were the Italians and Portuguese, and much less careful than Brazilian Francisco Carigal, perhaps due to the pride of being of a superior race. Francisco Carigal appears in the foreground in the photo, with his legs crossed, holding the ball. Written on the ball in chalk is the initials of the Bangu team and the date of the match photograph, 5-5-14, referring to May 14, 1905. The soccer cleats of Francisco Carigal look brand new, or at least polished, that morning for the game. One's attention is drawn to the difference between the plight of Francisco Carigal, concerned with not looking shabby, and the blasé air of William Proctor, who didn't give import to such things. Francisco Carigal, a simple weaver, had bought everything new, the soccer cleats, the short pants, the wool socks. The shirt was provided by the club. William Proctor, the master electrician, had ordered some old shoes cleated, had cut up with scissors a pair of white pants that were no longer of use, and chose not to buy the wool socks, which cost 8,000 reis in the Casa Clark store. Instead, he put his feet in common socks, which went only halfway up his legs, and he allowed himself to be photographed with black gaiters. The black gaiters really hurt the eyes against the white legs of William Proctor. It seemed that he hadn't finished dressing, that he had come running out from inside to pose for the photograph, without pants and underwear, principally because he is between Francisco Carigal, finely kitted out, and James Hartley, who, beyond woolen socks, wore shin guards on his legs. Shin guards were a rare thing, which had to be imported from Europe, like a true refinement. William Proctor could be careless. Francisco Carigal could not. Among the English, the Portuguese, and the Italians, he felt himself to be more mulatto, while wishing to appear less, almost white. He passed perfectly. At least he wasn't scandalizing anyone. If Manuel Mea, black goalkeeper, son of two black parents, was not pointed at, the mulatto center forward, Francisco Carigal, would not draw any attention. What harm did it do for a worker to play soccer? Would he stop being a worker for that reason? On Sunday, he would kick the ball around, sweating his shirt through, while early Monday morning, when the factory opened, he would be there. He would go to the looms like the other workers. He would work, stopping only for lunch until 4 o'clock. He didn't even have time to remember the previous day's match. And why remember it? Work was time for work, and the game, time for play. In the end, Bangu was, despite the, a club of workers of the industrial progress of Brazil Company. If not for the factory, how could the club provide a field? And the rest was everything. The worker who played alongside the masters, white or black, did not rise up or go down. He just remained where he was. If he wished to rise, he had to work a lot, to learn a lot, to be promoted from weaver to master. Just as Francisco Cadigal ended up being promoted, at the price of hard work rather than playing soccer. Soccer was a pastime. Like every pastime, it cost money. More or less, less in Bangu than on Retiro de Guanabara Street, where Fluminense had made its field. For this reason, there was no danger that a Francisco Cadigal, although a clean mulatto, or Manuel Mea, despite being a good, respectful black man, would join Fluminense. To join Fluminense, a player had to live the same life as an Oscar Cox, a Felix Frias, a Horatio da Costa Santos, a Waterman, a Francis Walter, an Echegaray, all made men, heads of firms, high officials in big companies, sons of wealthy fathers, educated in Europe, accustomed to spending money. It was a demanding life. Whoever lacked a good income, a good allowance, a good wage, would not be able to keep up. Just to give an idea, each player who went to Sao Paulo at the turn of the century to play a football match had to spend 130 mil reais on travel expenses. Oscar Cox, originator of the idea to create Fluminense, even tried to convince the central train station. He went there and said he was representing a Brazilian sporting delegation, the first that would go from Rio São Paulo, but got nothing. The central station did not discount even more rural ones. A soccer player was a passenger, like any other. Result? All the members of the nameless team were obliged to put their hands in their wallets. On the return, they settled accounts, 130 mil reais from each, real money, in that era of almost equal exchange with the pound. And in Sao Paulo, beyond the hotel bill, no one paid anything. One would buy a pack of cigarettes, a box of matches, and it was already paid for. A Paulista, or sometimes an Englishman or a German, had made a signal. Paid for. Everything was paid for. The hospitality, however, was an exchange. The Cariocas went to Sao Paulo, and the Paulistas came to Rio. And the Cariocas turned quickly, arrived to do the same, following the Paulistas around to pay their expenses. Once that period was over, fortunately, always quickly, 2 or 3 days at the most, otherwise there wouldn't be enough money, they would total everything up, calculate each share, and divide up the expenses. And after a game, there was always a celebration, generally in the Café Cantante Garda Velha restaurant, which was there on Senador Dantas Street. The victors would fraternize with the losers. The idea would come from the victors, the defeated still stunned, not ready to think about anything, much less a celebration. Celebration of a defeat? It was unbecoming to refuse, and the losers had to show themselves as on par with the victors, eating like them, drinking like them, singing like them, and principally paying them respects. Paying like them. When the time came to pay, there were no winners or losers. Everyone came together as bill payers, and the losers could even feel a vanity in their good sportsmanship of having contributed to the greater brilliance of the victor's party. And without covering their faces, without showing sadness or the pain of defeat, and without haggling over money. What the winners spent, the losers would spend. And these celebrations were not cheap. They continued into the wee hours, and did people drink? Therein lay the fun, in drinking a lot. The more they would drink, the more they would sing. Everyone standing, with a stain of draft beer in hand, singing and swaying their head, following the rhythm with a loud voice, the louder the better. When we more drink together, more quickly, more friends we be. Slowly the words dragged out. When more we drink together, quickly, more friends we be. Slowly the words dragged out. It was not that English song to end parties, an end that never came, that the young men of Botafogo, almost boys beside the real Balzacian men of Fluminense, translated into Portuguese. When more we drink together, ended up as Onde mora o Pinta Guindes, where Pinto Guindes lives, while For he is a jolly good fellow became A beleza e bolo de ferro. The post is an iron ball. It worked fine. Also, everyone was a little bit more rather than less in the bag, not hearing very well with the half-deafness of a good bender. The English didn't even notice the exchange of words, or if they did, they remained for that reason. Not even the waiters, coming and going, taking the empty glasses and bringing full ones, noticed the thing. The impression given was that everyone was singing in English. Only the Englishmen and the Germans were singing thusly, glasses in hand. It was not cheap to commemorate a victory for the winners or the losers. Many a young man, disassembled, failed to show up or even left the club. Their allowance had not arrived. And the players saved their money. They didn't spend without reason. If they had some old white pants, they wouldn't buy shorts. They would cut the pants at knee length or a little lower, and presto, some old boots with cleats could serve as soccer shoes. Money was saved for other things, which would certainly arise. When Oscar Koch discovered a piece of land located on Guanabara Street with Rosal Street access, there was no debate. Fluminense had 30 members, each one paying a monthly fee of 5 mil reis. The piece of land alone would eat up 100 mil reis of the total receipts of 150. If money was lacking, however, they would open up a subscription period. Subscriptions were never lacking. For this, for that, a shack that needed to be built, the field that needed a fence, shirts and balls, no balls were arriving. Each one 25 mil reis. Fluminense, even when they had only a field without grass or of bare earth, a wire fence stretched between stakes of rough wood, a mud hut there in the back where the players changed their clothes, an improvised open-air shower did not need to concern itself with color, with the social condition of their players.
All righty. That will do us for our first installment. We are ending at the conclusion of Chapter 1. We can pick up from the very beginning of Chapter 2 next week in The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. The Katherine Massey Book Club. Number is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The email untiljustice@gmail.com. Get our investor. I'll finish his notes on Chapter 1. Incidentally, I think it was Lauren. She said Frederick Douglass was talking about his line. That would be a cowbell one, Frederick Douglass. But she said the problem of the color line, that is W.E.B. Du Bois' infamous statement. The problem of the color line is the problem of the 20th century. The great W.E.B. Du Bois. Okay, so notes, Chapter 1. Dr. Welsing mentions that quote frequently and then pivots to Mr. Fuller. Number 2, page 1. Industrial Progress Company of Brazil sent to find masters in England. The English masters founded the Bangu Athletic Club. For the masters and workers, the Englishmen of Bangu. The use of the word masters. And this text was interesting. I'm not saying its use was necessarily inaccurate. I don't think it would be inaccurate either. I mean, slavery, didn't he just say we had the master's house and the slave's house? He just said that. Like, I think it's totally, that's what it's, master's tournament, they use it in their ball games on a regular basis. Number three, page two, the Englishmen got along well with the Germans when they got together. Didn't feel so foreign. In other words, organizing themselves around their whiteness. We hear a lot of that white bonding throughout this book. I commented on that before. You know, these are folks, they've had whole wars in together. Going to have more. World War II on the horizon down the road. And we even hear those stories during World War II. We're white. We shouldn't even be doing all this. Let's get together. Remember that we are white brothers. My white brother. White sister. Let's see. The number four, English colony of Bangu, cricket, even a white Brazilian couldn't make it on a cricket team. The ball was made of wood covered in leather. Bangu has two meanings. Number one, Tupi, indigenous language, black wall. Number two, name given by slaves for the sugar cane mill that was there. Today it contains a large maximum security complex, Bangu Penitentiary Complex. Now that is interesting. The colony of Bangu. And I don't have to think, especially that last one, the slaves. That was the name for the sugarcane mill. Got another one of those. We just had Dr. Jared Ross Hardesty, his book, The Mutiny on the Rising Sun, where that was all about chocolate and sugar in the Caribbean. And then, bang, pop right back into Jeff Dahmer and chocolate and sugar. And number five, before installing the field, English precaution installed the bar. Could then think about the field. The presence of alcohol in the global system of racism, white supremacy is ubiquitous. It is like a, what would you call it? A lubricant for homo social white bonding. We just talked about that. We had Dr. Jack E. Davis on the program. We talked about the lynching of Jesse James Payne in his book on the history of racism in Mississippi. He had the pictures of the white fox hunt. It's about the same thing. They would get together, drink, and go out, chase the fox, and then come back and drink, celebrate afterwards, presumably. But all that homo, we got to get liquored up. In fact, he had the same scene before they went out to lynch Jesse James Payne. Meet, get to the bar, get some whiskey. This is great. Yes, our white brothers, our white men, yes. Said that's what this book is about, being a man, manhood in Brazil, South America, white masculinity. But I mean, hey, and then that is always, always in competition with and in domination of black males. Again, we are recreating Africa, institutional rape of black males. Keep that in mind. Number seven, six. Mulatto, page five. Mulatto, the Bangu shirt was not like it is today, knit and tight, fitting broad stripes in red and white pattern. When the players became more black, did the clothing get tighter? Not sure. I know some of the athletic, particularly where they have collision, they're doing more tighter jerseys so that there's no excess cloth that can be grabbed. And so that it is really accented if you are grabbing someone's jersey because it is so tight and snug. I know that has become more popular to get away from having all that excess jersey in all of the collision sports, even basketball. Number seven, page nine, join the Fluminese without a shadow of a doubt, that metaphor shadow. A good family just wanting a legitimate white man, nobody thinking in terms of color of race. Prado was black from an illustrious, rich family. Good family equals white family in my mind. No one was thinking in terms of race. I have doubts in my mind. Me too. They're always, white people are always thinking in terms of race. Number eight. Page 11, Oscar Cox took 4 years from 1897 to 1901 to form a team, 5 years to found a club. The club was Fluminense. Cox was born in Brazil and received an education in Switzerland. Brought the sport to Rio de Janeiro, September Second, 1901, he organized the first match. Fluminense is still in existence. Jesus, white ball games. Number 9, page 16. Win but don't take. When Bangu won, no problem. When Bangu lost, rocks would come flying. Breaking, it was a class war rivalry, suburban club from the city. Bangu had its Englishmen whiter than Brazilians of Botafogo, factory workers, poor whites, mulattoes, blacks. Hooliganism associated with soccer has a long history, indeed. Number 10, page 17, Bangu Factory Club. Oh, we didn't get that far. I was thinking, like, wait a minute, did we get that far? We didn't get that far. We'll pick up as we get further into the book for next week. Pause right there. Let's see, the email again, untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. We'll get your comments in. And the number 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you have commentary. Again, I know this one is challenging. I don't know how many soccer fans we have, folks who were just watching the World Cup, bated breath, the whole championship and what have you, bummed about France's loss and all the rest of it. But, man, South America, Brazil specifically, so much attention, and specifically talking about transporting, they'll say, extremism, right-wing extremism. Between the U.S. and Brazil, this is a great time to study this area. And again, the confusion for an area that has such an extraordinarily high population of dark people, people that would be classified as black, no doubt. Confusion. If you have commentary, let us know. Let us see. See, Lauren, I'll look for other hands as we proceed. Lauren, did anything stand out? Second portion of the reading? Just listening.
Yes, sir. I have a couple of things. I don't know a lot about soccer, so I don't know. I guess keep that in mind with my comments and whatnot. But there was a lot of talk about mustaches. It seemed excessive. I didn't know what to make of that. And then they talked about Francisco Carrigal. He's the only non-white person on the team. And it says, maybe because he was Brazilian and mulatto, the only Brazilian and the only mulatto on the team, was a perfectionist in the way he dressed. He was the best dressed player on Bangu, a real dandy on the field. Man, that made me think about non-white black people in this area of the world. Right now, we do a lot of fancy dressing. I heard someone say, I'm sure more than one person had said it, but like the people, black people in this area of the world called the United States, we're the best dressed poor in the world. And calling him a real dandy on the field, I thought dandy was another way to say gay. Well, if you're not gay, effeminate. And I also contrasted the way he went about it with the white man on the team. Hold on. Let me see. It says they were less careful in their manner of dress than were the Italians and the Portuguese. And much less careful than Brazilian Francisco Carrigal, perhaps due to the pride of being a superior race. Yeah, it says once attention is drawn to the difference between the plight of Francisco Carrigal, concerned with not looking shabby, and the blasé air of William Proctor, who didn't give import to such things. And it said Francisco, who was a weaver, had bought everything new, the cleats, the pants, the wool socks, all of this stuff. And then the white man just put his feet in common socks, which went only halfway up his legs, and he allowed himself to be photographed with black gaiters. And I think this is the author saying the black gaiters really hurt the eyes against the white legs of William Proctor. It seemed that he hadn't finished dressing, that he had come running out from inside to pose for the photograph without pants and underwear. That made me think of Dr. Welding when she talked about the mythology, the Adam and Eve mythology, and the symbolism of that, what she thought it really meant. Them being ashamed of their nakedness was, you know, being ashamed of their depigmented skin. Let me see. Okay. And then it said William Proctor could be careless. Francisco Carrigal could not. Among the English, the Portuguese, and the Italians, I guess that just means the whites, he felt himself to be more mulatto, that means non-white, while wishing to appear less, almost white. He passed perfectly. I don't even know how to process that. He just said he's a mulatto, which means non-white, and then says he passed perfectly. I don't know what that means. I guess that's, well, I do the drinking that would occur after the games and the money that would need to be spent. It seemed like people didn't have a lot of money, and they were spending a lot of money on the drinking. I was just wondering about that, if it was constructive. And it said it was a celebration of a defeat. It was unbecoming to refuse, and the losers had to show themselves as on par with the victors. Eating like them, drinking like them, singing like them, and principally paying like them. That's pretty interesting. That's all I have for now. Thanks.
Much obliged. Lauren, let's see. Make sure I get... Okay. Number one, that word dandy, just... My mind was drifting back. The great Jack Johnson was referred to as a dandy. He was former heavyweight champion, talking about professional athletes in almost the same time period. He was a heavyweight champion in the early 20th century, about 20 years before Pele's, or maybe even a little bit more than that, but early part of the 20th, about the same time period that we're talking about. But dandy... Definition, a man unduly devoted to style, neatness, and fashion in dress and appearance. Now that's unduly, that almost makes it seem like this is not a compliment. Now, it gives synonyms. One of the synonyms, glamour boy. I never even heard that before. Now, it also has sharp dresser, which seems more like, you know, a compliment. But glamour boy. Pretty boy. It's also there. Like, not necessarily a compliment, so to speak. But so that's one for dandy. Then with these gaiters, in this contrast, you're going to wear these black gaiters and doesn't even look like you're dressed all the way. Oh my gosh. The grandsester, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing, in the ISIS papers, Alienation, Anxiety, and Narcissism, she writes, from a more recent literary work than the Bible, the famous 19th century novelist Herman Melville, in his profoundly symbolic work about white supremacy, system, culture, Moby Dick, states, what is it that in the albino man so peculiarly repels and often shocks the eye, as that sometimes he is loathed by his own kith and kin? It is that whiteness which invests him, a thing expressed by the name he bears. The albino is a well-made as other men, is as well-made as other men, has no substantive deformity, and yet this mere aspect of all-pervading whiteness makes him more strangely hideous than the ugliest abortion. Why should this be so? She continues, another famous American author, Mark Twain, in a collection of articles entitled Mark Twain on the Damned Human Race, compliments Melville's assessment in his essay Skin Deep. Twain's analysis suggests the depth of alienation experienced by whites, albinos. Nearly all black and brown skins are beautiful, but a beautiful white skin is rare. How rare, one may learn by walking down a street in Paris, New York, London, whole world, on a weekday, particularly in an unfashionable street, and keeping count of the satisfactory complexions encountered in the course of a mile. Where dark complexions are masked, they make the whites look bleached out, unwholesome, and sometimes, frankly, ghastly. I could notice this as a boy down south in the slavery days before the war. The splendid black skin of the South African Zulus of Durban seemed to me to come very close to perfection. I can see those Zulus yet handsome and intensely black creatures. Got some sexual... moderately clothed in loose summer stuffs whose snowy whiteness... seemed to me to come very close to perfection. I can see the Zulus yet handsome and intensely black creatures moderately clothed in those loose summer stuffs whose snowy whiteness made the black all the blacker by contrast. Keeping that group in mind, I can compare those complexions with the white ones which are streaming past this London window now. Twain continues detailing the negative attributes of white skin. The advantage is the Zulu. I think he starts with a beautiful complexion and it will last him through. And as for the Indian, brown, firm, smooth, blemishless, pleasant, and restful to the eye, afraid of no color, harmonizing with all colors and adding grace to them all, I think there is no sort of chance for the average white complexion against the rich and perfect tint. I will stop there. The grandcestor. The second portion of the reading mixture I missed got knocked off of the page for the... There we go. Make sure I didn't miss any folks if they have commentary to add. Like I said, more challenging read, but man, number of folks who've said that they are at least curious about Brazil. If that is true, you should at least, have some word, what have you, in terms of, or some thought process about the text as we read on, and particularly comparison and contrast to, you know, what's going on currently in that part of the world. Let's see, looking back at my notes here. Back. The mustache, I got that too, make sure I didn't miss anything. The drinking, of course. First portion. So cricket, now that's another one that I don't know anything about. I'm aware of it, but I've never played, never watched anything of that nature. In cricket, the Englishman refused any talk of mixture in terms of we're not going to have anybody on the team, even if you are white and Brazilian, you couldn't be on the team. Now, that is hierarchy right there. We are so snobbish with our athletic competitions and what have you, our ball games, that even a white man born someplace else, got to be white and English, be on our cricket team. This is Brazilians were never much for cricket, me either. The players pad themselves wearing something close to medieval armor in order to wield their bat. And he has bat in italics. In addition, the ball was made of wood covered in leather. If it hit the leg of a player, it could break it. Like, the violence of all of this, we got to be in medieval armor and you could break a bone at a time when they didn't even have all the advanced highfalutin medical technology that they have in many parts of the world now. And then the black leather ball. I mean, wow, Dr. Wellsing every page, right? All these ball games. And then they got to be real fanatic about this one. The small black ball, and I got our bat phallic symbol to go out here. And they got to drink all day. They say they start at 9 o'clock in the morning with all this. Like, man, we don't want to get wait
till the evening, maybe, before we start our liquor consumption? We got to start right with the crack of dawn, as they say. Let's see. So we got Chico the Doorman. What a nickname. Like, are you serious? Chico the Doorman? That's Francisco de Barros, a factory guard who was constantly rattling the woodwork, who only saw the ball and nothing else. And Justino Fortes, a giant the size of William Hellowell, and one Brazilian, Francisco Cargill, a Brazilian with 50% black blood. I thought they said that they didn't pay attention to color and all of that. How would that even be known? And that's another one. What does that even mean? Like, there are whole books written about how that right there, there's no such thing as black blood or white blood or Asian. All of that is absolute nonsense. System of racism, white supremacy, confusion. Black mother, Brazilian. Wait a minute. This is white. His father was white and Portuguese. His mother, black and Brazilian. That would be another one I would say is rape. Let's see. All of this about him being a mulatto and he's got to be a perfectionist. I think Lauren spot on in that. And I think you see a lot of that even today. We've heard this before. Individuals who there might be some question about their acceptance as white. I got to be really careful about what I wear, what I dress, who I hang around. Like, I have heard this even from individuals who are just non-white. They have two non-white parents who feel the same way, that I have to do a lot to compensate because I'm a victim of racism so that I can be, you know, get the best treatment possible under these conditions. And to contrast this, where you have this white man who doesn't care at all. You know, I can go out and wear whatever I want to, and it doesn't matter. In fact, even before he gets to all that, when he talks about this photograph that is so amazing, the whiteness of the photograph, he says there's a photograph of this Bangutin, a photo truly worthy of saving in an album. Frederick Jacques, master engraver, the goalkeeper in the back, standing between Jose Villas Boas, director of sports, and João Ferrer, honorary president of Bangu. João Ferrer is in an all white, his white clothes and white collar blending together, this white chest covering and white tie. Like, why? And even Jose Villas Boas in his pale gray, like, man, like, the white photo has to be treasured and saved by all for centuries to come. Yes, because of the white whiteness of it. Yes. Okay. Lauren talked about the mustaches as well, which I also thought was interesting. And again, just looking at the books we've read in order, Bill Russell, he said that they almost made a rule about facial hair just because he had a short mustache and a little bit of a goatee. And then the no good Negro giant Wilt Chamberlain had the audacity to get a little bit of a mustache. I think he might have had a goatee as well. Can't have these niggers, and this is like 50 years later, can't have these niggers wearing facial hair. We got to make a rule about this. Remember, we just talked about that. So to have here these white people, and like, this seems kind of dandyish to me, right? Pretty boy. Undue focus by males on, like, what? Oh, because this is a chunky paragraph. He says mustache was quite Italian. I don't even know what that means. A daring little mustache with fine tips pointing upward. That of Francisco de Barros, Chico the Doorman. What a name. Was not daring at all. On the contrary, it was an austere mustache. What is that? Weighted down with the responsibility of a what? What is a mustache that is weighted down by fatherhood? What does that, like, what? What? And then he goes on to John Starks and his mustache and, wow, it sounds a little effeminate to me, honestly. Like I said, and again, this is such a strong contrast. You would think after the passage of 50 years, it would be no big deal, like Bill Russell and, you know, Wilt Chamberlain to have a mustache. Like, that would be the least of our concerns. Like, oh, they got a little bit of peach fuzz or whatever else, you know. This is, oh my gosh. And even, he says, the mustache of William Proctor was black, darkening his face. That of James Hartley was blonde, almost white, making him look older. Male grooming habits, the early 20th century, I don't know, in South America. Let's see. The black gator portion, stunning. Dr. Welsing would have had a field day on that. Just got that in from the ISIS papers. Directly hurt the eyes, like, wow. I think that is an indictment. Dr. Welsing couldn't have said it better.
Like he didn't finish dressing, Lauren said. Like, man, could Dr. Welsing couldn't have said it better. And then all that, the mulatto, so-called, the non-white male, he can't be careless like this. He can't just run out with anything that's going to hurt the eyes. Like, whoa, 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 I'm not a white man. I got to make sure that I am impeccable, maybe even wear a whole lot of white. Got to be perfect. Let's see. The cost of all of this I thought was important as well, because that continues to be, I guess, not so much for soccer. I would think today, I mean, you don't even need a ball. Like, you just need, just if you can find a field where they are playing, you can go join, and that's that. So I would guess you probably wouldn't need as much equipment today if you wanted to play soccer. But for so many sports, we just had that report talking about going skiing. Swimming, talked about so many black people, they can't swim, horseback riding, so many of these sports that are expensive can be difficult to play. Now, that's even something to think about, because football, tackle football, is not cheap. It's a lot of equipment. Like, you got to get a whole uniform and shoulder pads and a helmet and a mouthpiece and cleats, and it's a lot of equipment. It's not just get a ball and go out on the field and knock somebody's brains out. Like, they somehow are able to get all of that equipment for black people to go out and get brain damage for sports that would be safer, where you don't have all these head collisions. It's expensive. I don't know if we can get Serena Williams, get the next generation of Serena Williams. It's pricey. Golf. But brain damage, oh yeah, we can get tons of y'all. Yes, line up right now. Let's see. They got to go out and drink. So we already had, so they get up in the morning, 9 o'clock in the morning. They put specific time on it, detail, right? So they said 9 o'clock in the morning, we get up and start drinking. We go out, we play the game, win, lose. You lose by 50, you win by 5, whatever it is, we go drink. Like, are you serious? Oh, and particularly now that we got the science, new data and what have you, that, hey, all that drinking is not even healthy. The fancy C word, carcinogenic, right? That's not even something that you want to be engaging in. You go out and do all that running around. Hey, I have seen data where you go out and do all that ripping and running. The best thing to drink would be water. In fact, all that alcohol consumption, that is dehydrating, I think, as they say. I am not a doctor or an expert on soccer. Let's see. Make sure. Got every. Oh, that is it. That is it. Because we had all those chunky notes at the beginning, right? From the, translator. And then from the actual author, Mr. Filo. So we really only got through chapter one. So next week we'll be able to hopefully get much deeper into the text and learn a little bit more. We didn't even get to Pelé, right? We didn't really hear his name at all. Like, he was kind of setting up the background on everything. So we didn't even really get the main star of the text. But I guess that'll be next week. Stay tuned. Anywho, we will be here tomorrow, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, for Neutralizing Workplace Racism. Let us know what's going down on the job in the start of the new year. With that, much obliged for the folks who tuned in. Hopefully it was worthy of your Thursday evening, learning a little bit about South America, the great Pelé, or to come. With that, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy, given what we heard. I guess I can contradict happily the text for health reasons, many reasons. Especially if you're going to go out and be athletic, get some exercise in, water would be the best thing to drink, not to go out and get liquored out. Even if you want to go out and celebrate, if you all went out and played something non-contact, no collisions, you all go out and maybe play flag football, you all go out and do a little bit of soccer, no collisions, no headers, you all can go out and celebrate, have some produce, fruits, vegetables, lots of water, smoothie maybe. Celebrate, good job, great competition, we got some exercise, no brain damage, and we all go home and get a good night's rest. Sounds amazing. Anyway, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy anywhere in the world.
Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No name calling, no throwaway offspring, no gossiping. Doing our best to get this problem solved ASAP. Cows signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, no brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.